Good evening and welcome to the Museum of Science. Thank you all for joining us this evening. A couple of housekeeping items before we get started. Please silence all cell phones and pagers. And if you need to leave before the program ends, please use the doors at the rear. This program is being filmed tonight for the WGBH Forum Network. So if you'd like to see it again or view many of our wonderful programs for adults, you can do that on wgbh.org/forums. Colonel Percy Fawcett was a renowned British explorer whose adventures into blank spots on the map have enthralled the public for more than a century. Fawcett has been described as a man of indomitable will, infinite resource, fearless. David Grann is a writer for The New Yorker who lives in Manhattan. By his own admission, he would rather take the elevator than the stairs, and he doesn't enjoy camping very much. The paths of these two men crossed deep in the Amazon as each followed an obsession. For Fawcett, it was the lure of the glittering golden kingdom of El Dorado. For David Grann, the obsession was Fawcett's story and the quest to discover the truth about the lost city of Z. Percy Fawcett never did emerge from the forest, from the jungle, but fortunately, David Grann did. He joins us tonight to talk about his adventures, his discoveries, and his new book, The Lost City of Z. Please welcome David Grann.
Thank you so much, all of you, for coming this evening and to the museum for having me. And as Monica aptly put it, as you can tell, I'm not an explorer, not an adventurer. I don't hike, I don't camp, I'm afraid of snakes. I have keratoconus, which is a degenerative eye condition, which makes it extremely hard for me even to see your faces. I tend to get lost on the subway, even on my way to work in Manhattan. So the question some of you might be wondering, indeed the question my wife is definitely still wondering, is how did a guy like me, a reporter, end up in the Amazon trying to solve what has been described as the greatest exploration mystery of the 20th century? What happened to the legendary British explorer, Percy Harrison Fawcett, who disappeared in 1925 looking for an ancient civilization, a place he had called simply and rather cryptically the Lost City of Z? I first heard about this mystery when I was doing another story for the magazine at The New Yorker on the death of a leading Conan Doyle scholar. And in the course of that research, I came upon a reference that Fawcett had helped to inspire Conan Doyle's novel, The Lost World. And I'm just going to cue up a quick little clip from a film adaptation of that movie so you can get some sense.
I further propose that a new expedition consisting of Professor Summerlee and myself, together with two impartial and acceptable members of this audience, proceed at once to the Amazon to investigate my claim of the existence of a lost world.
Hear, hear.
Well said.
In any case, I had read the novel, and it piqued my curiosity. So I plugged Fawcett's name into one of these newspaper databases we have at magazines and newspapers, and historical database, and up came all these crazy headlines. Here, my little thing is working, here's an iconic picture of Percy Harrison Fawcett from one of his early expeditions. And in any case, I plugged his name into a newspaper database, and up came these kind of outlandish headlines that sounded like something out of Pulp Fiction. And here you get some sense of the racist attitudes of the time. This is an article from the 1930s. But they were these headlines, Fawcett Party disappears into the unknown, another Fawcett Party vanishes, this guy who says savages see movie actor seeking to rescue Fawcett. And I soon discovered that Fawcett was the last of the great territorial explorers, men who ventured into blank spots on the map with little more than a machete, a compass, and almost a divine sense of purpose. Even before he disappeared in 1925, stories of his adventures had captivated the public's imagination. How he would survive for years in the wilderness without contact with the outside world, how he would encounter tribes that had never before seen a white man, and how he would emerge from regions from which no expedition had come back from with maps. And here you can see a drawing of one of his earlier maps. And a lot of his maps are actually much more detailed, and they look almost like pointillist paintings. They're actually quite beautiful. Fawcett had such unrivaled powers of endurance that a few colleagues even claimed that he was immune to death. An American explorer said that he could outwalk, outhike, and out-explore anybody else. In 1955, the Royal Geographical Society's journal said, "Fawcett marked the end of an age. One might almost call him the last of the individualist explorers. The day of the airplane, the radio, the organized and heavily financed modern expedition had not arrived. With him, it was the heroic story of man against the forest." Fawcett began his expeditions in the Amazon in 1906. And by then, most of the world had already been explored, but the Amazon really remained. This is a man who actually helped train Fawcett to become a gentleman explorer at the Royal Geographic Society. And then in 1906, he went to the into the jungle. And as I was saying, the Amazon really remained at that time one of the last large blank spots on the map. And just to give you some sense of its size, the Amazonian wilderness is the size of the, or virtually the size of the continental United States. And because of the forest, it was virtually impenetrable to outsiders for centuries. And so it remained truly unknown. One of the secretaries of the Royal Geographical Society, a man named Kelty, who was one of the more acclaimed geographers in his day, said at the time, "What is there? No one knows." The area remained so unexplored in large parts that the countries of Brazil, Peru, and Bolivia didn't even know where their borders were in the interior of the Amazon. They were simply speculative lines sketched through forests and mountains. And so they needed somebody to come in and try to determine their boundaries, and they had consulted with the Royal Geographical Society, which was in the process of trying to map various parts of the world, if they had a representative who was willing to go on this mission, which was seen as fairly suicidal. And Fawcett, believing it was his destiny, quickly volunteered. And he began to map thousands of square miles of the wilderness. And here, just to give you some sense of the size, down here is Bolivia. Up here we have Brazil and Peru. And here was his first expedition in 1906. And what they would do is they would take pack animals, they would actually go over the Andes and so climb up about 16, 17,000 feet, and then they would slowly descend down. Often their pack animals would fall off the ravines, and they would slowly descend deeper and deeper into the jungle and head out into this area. And so this is the area where he did his early route, but this is a huge, vast territory that he was covering for years, mapping thousands of square miles of the jungle. And these expeditions were pretty extraordinary in their own right. They had very few protections against the assault of the jungle. As I was saying just a little bit earlier, Fawcett actually trained at the Royal Geographic Society, which served almost as like a finishing school for explorers. It had helped launch Burton and Speke and Livingston. And they would teach you not only how to map, but they would teach you how to survive. And I read the manuals, which Fawcett had also read to study. And they were fairly barbaric, reflecting the time period. For example, if you were bitten by a poisonous snake, it advised you to pack the wound with gunpowder and explode it. And if you were hit by a poisonous arrow, for example, and had a hemorrhaging wound, it told you to fill it with pour boiling grease into it. And so this gives you some sense of the time period when you're heading in this and kind of how different it was from today. And they would have to confront pit vipers and vampire bats. They would often describe in their diaries, they would go to bed at night and they would wake up with blood streaking down their skin from vampire bats, which would pick at them and also at their pack animals. Fawcett, here he is in one of his earlier trips. This is from a 1908 trip. He's still a fairly young man here. You can see him with his surveying equipment. He once encountered an anaconda. I encountered several anacondas, but one of his encounters with a snake that was fairly large became somewhat lore in England, and there was great headlines. Great Snakes was one of the great British headlines. And actually, this drawing was done by Fawcett's youngest son, Brian, and he tried to imagine what that encounter was like with his father, and there his father is shooting the snake. And it was drawings like this that helped fuel the legend. But even a frog could be deadly to the touch. And this frog here is only about the size of a coin. It's called a Philobatus terribilis, and it has enough toxins in it to kill 100 people. And many of the greatest obstacle, though, they faced was not large predators, as we often think about. It was actually the ceaseless pests. It was the mosquitoes. There was nothing more lethal. They transported everything from malaria to yellow fever to bone crusher fever to elephantiasis. And unlike today, the men had no immunities. They had no malaria pills, no shots for yellow fever. And Fawcett would take these parties in, and usually half his men, if not more, would die of disease on these trips. And if it were yellow fever, what they feared most was spitting up vomit, spitting up blood, the so-called black vomit, which meant the end was near. And if it was malaria, which about 80% of the people was estimated back then contracted if they were working in the Amazon, they would experience hallucinations and often slip into a coma and die. And Fawcett would describe burying men along the banks of the rivers and leaving nothing more than a few twigs to mark their graves. Reading the diaries of Fawcett's companions who went with him is fairly compelling and disconcerting reading. They would often start off with great romance about their experience and their great ambitions, and then they would slowly become delirious from disease. And this poor fellow here was named Ernest Holt. He went with Fawcett in 1921 on an expedition. He had great ambitions of being the next great naturalist like Darwin. But slowly, as the expedition went on, he was supposed to be cataloging fauna and flora. And as the expedition went on, halfway through his diary, which I was reading, all he starts to catalog are the bugs that are eating him. And this goes on for days and days and days. And he's literally driven virtually mad by them. And I'll just read you a few days from his diary to give you some sense in his own words. November 20th, attacked in hammock by tiny gnat. Not over 1/10 inch in length. Mosquito nets, no protection. Gnats bite all night, allowing no sleep. November 21st, another sleepless night, a kind of blood-sucking gnats. November 22nd, my body mass of bumps from insect bites, wrists and hands swollen from bites of tiny gnats. Two nights with almost no sleep, simply terrible. November 24th, more than half ill from insects, wrists and hands swollen. December 3rd, bees and gnats worse than ever. Truly, there's no rest for the weary. December 5th, my first experience with flesh and carrion eating bees, biting gnats in clouds, very worst we have encountered, rendering one's food unpalatable by filling it with their filthy bodies, their bellies red and disgustingly distended with one's own blood. And finally, days of toil, nights of torture, an explorer's life. Where is the romance now? Fawcett was also conducting these expeditions during the bloody era of the rubber Amazon boom. And what happened was, because of the development of cars in various parts of the world, and tires, and Goodrich, and Goodyear, rubber was in great demand. And rubber was found in plants in the Amazon. But the conditions were extremely difficult to tap rubber from rubber plants. And so labor was always in short supply. And so these rubber barons would send in their men to enslave the Indians and the Amazonian tribes. And if the Amazonian tribes resisted, they were often massacred. And the accounts of this brutality are incredibly shocking. I mean, there was one company which was allegedly had murdered, just this one company alone, up to 30,000 Indians. But because of this, it also meant exploration in these areas made it utterly treacherous, because even once friendly tribes now would ambush any interlopers or trespassers. And Fawcett would head into these areas. And very counterintuitively, he would only take a few men. Early Amazon expeditions from the days of the conquistadors always took 100, often thousands of men. The first Amazon expedition consisted of thousands of literally armed men wearing armor, which was probably a bit foolish in the jungle. But Fawcett believed you could only take a few men. It was easier to live off the land. But more importantly, it was the only way to persuade the tribes of his peaceful intentions. And unlike many of his colleagues from that time period, he refused to let his men fire on the Indians under any circumstances. And in kind of crazy, mad Victorian fashion, he would often order his men to drop their guns if they were being ambushed, sing, "God Save the Queen." And he would then take off his handkerchief, and they always wore handkerchiefs. They tried to keep everything covered from insect bites, and he would take off his handkerchief, and while his men sang behind him, he would walk with his hands above his head. And these accounts are all documented, not just from Fawcett, which, you know, one might think he would embellish, but all his companions would describe these in their diaries and say he was essentially nuts. If one of Fawcett's men became sick or was wounded or was too debilitated, there was a strict rule in the parties: abandonment. They couldn't carry you out. They had to get across too many miles through dense wilderness, and to try to carry out a wounded man over that distance meant risking the welfare of the entire party. And I want to just read to you just a few quick passages from the book, just to give you a sense of these early expeditions. This reading takes place from a 1908 expedition in search of the Rio Verde. And I think I have bad eyesight, as you know, I think it's over there somewhere. It was in Brazil. The river, nobody knew the source of the river. It was unknown. No one had, at least from outsiders, no one knew it, had never been charted. And it evoked some of the romance, like the search for the source of the Nile River, of Burton and Speke. And this certainly excited Fawcett's imagination, so he was determined to find that source. Despite cutting, chopping, pulling, and pushing through jungle from morning till night, they usually advanced no more than half a mile per day. Their legs sank in mud, their shoes disintegrated, their eyes blurred from a tiny species of bee that is drawn to sweat and that invaded their pupils. Brazilians called them eye lickers. Fawcett counted his paces and crawled up banks to better see the stars and to fix their position, as if reducing the wilderness to figures and diagrams might enable him to overcome it. His men didn't need such signposts. They knew where they were, the green hell. The men were supposed to conserve their rations, but most broke down and consumed them quickly. Within days, they had run out of food. The men wanted to turn back, but Fawcett was determined to find the Verde source. They stumbled forward, mouths open, trying to capture every drop of rain. At night, chills swept through their bodies. A tocandera, a poisonous ant that can cause vomiting and intense fever, had infected Fisher. That was one of Fawcett's assistants. And a tree had fallen on the legs of another member of the party, so that his load had to be dispersed among the others. Fisher muttered that they were going to leave our bones here. Others prayed for salvation. They had gone nearly a month with no food. Their blood pressure plummeted, and their bodies consumed their own tissue. Quote, "The voices of the others and the sounds of the forest seemed to come from a vast distance, as though through a long tube," Fawcett wrote in his diary. As they staggered on, many of the men, inured to their fate, no longer tried to slap at the pestilent mosquitoes or keep watch against the Indians. An ambush, in spite of its moment of terror and agony, is quickly over, and if we regard these matters in a reasonable way, it would be considered merciful compared with starvation, Fawcett wrote. Finally, the men reached what appeared to be the source of the river. Fawcett took measurements, even though he was so depleted that he had trouble moving his limbs. The party paused momentarily for a photograph. They looked like dead men, their cheeks whittled to the bones, their beards matted against their faces like growth from the forest, their eyes half mad. Here's that photograph. You can see them. On that expedition, Fawcett took 9 men, and more than half of them died from disease and starvation. When Fawcett finally returned to La Paz, a virtual skeleton, he sent off a telegram to the Royal Geographical Society. It said simply, "Hel Verde conquered." It was during these treks that Fawcett began to develop his unorthodox and very radical theory that the Amazon may contain remnants of an ancient civilization. Ever since Francisco Orellana and his army of Spanish conquistadors descended the Amazon River in 1542, perhaps no place on the planet had so ignited the imagination or lured men to their death. Sir Walter Raleigh had described Indians literally with their heads beneath their shoulders. And here you can see a 16th century drawing depicting that. And it gives you some sense of what a fantastical place this region seemed in the European imagination. It was literally a dreamscape. what was true about the region, snakes that could be as long as buses, rats that could be the size of a pig, here's a caballero rat, seemed so far-fetched that no embellishment seemed too fanciful. And the most entrancing vision of all had always been of El Dorado. The kingdom of El Dorado, which the conquistadors had heard about from the Indians, was said to be so plentiful in gold that the inhabitants would ground the metal, the golden metal, into powder and literally blow it through hollow canes upon their naked bodies until they'd be shining from the head to the foot. And here again, you could see a 16th century drawing illuminating that. Yet each expedition that had searched for El Dorado had ended in disaster. The first El Dorado expedition had some 4,000 men, and some 4,000 men died of disease and starvation. Other parties descended into cannibalism, eating their own. Many went mad. And it was after a toll of death and suffering, pretty much worthy of Joseph Conrad, that most people concluded that El Dorado was no more than a delusion. In fact, many modern scientists assumed that no complex civilization could have ever developed in the Amazon. In 1971, Betty Meggers, who was perhaps the most influential archaeologist to have worked in the Amazon, famously summed up the region as a counterfeit paradise, a place that, despite all its flora and fauna, is really inimical to human life. She argued that because of this pounding sun and the floods and the rains, that the soil got leached of nutrients, and so it became very infertile. And because of that, it was very hard to grow agriculture in virtually impossible areas. And so they argued that essentially the Indians could not develop enough food supply to support a large population. And a large population is a precursor to any complex society with divisions of labor and political hierarchies such as chieftains or kingdoms. But Fawcett, who explored this area from 1906, nearly two decades, all the way up to his final expedition in 1925, began to believe that these assumptions were false. He made contact with various tribes that had never been contacted before in the wilderness. And the further he pushed in, the deeper he went where tribes had retreated from the assault of settlers, the larger he found their populations, the more he found that their cultures were robust, that they had not been decimated by disease, that they had vibrant cultures. More importantly, he found that they were often able to generate large food supplies. He would often wander into these settlements starving. Here he is with his longtime assistant, Costin, who went with him on many of his expeditions. This is a tribe that had never before seen white men. It was classified as the Mashubi tribe. Fawcett classified them as such. It was in the Brazilian Amazon. And Fawcett was quickly struck by how much food they had and how they had adapted brilliantly to the conditions in the jungle. They would often use the Amazonian floodplains, which were more fertile than terra firma, to grow crops. And they had come up with ingenious ways of hunting and fishing, often using poisons and various other ways. And food, he said, never bothered them. Fawcett also began to study the accounts of the El Dorado hunters. And this is one of the early chronicles that he looked at. Now, even though the early El Dorado conquistadors who had gone in looking for this fantastical golden kingdom never found their kingdom of gold, they described in their accounts large settlements, large populations, cities that glistened with white, bridges, roads, causeways, and pottery that was highly refined. Now, later settlers who went into the later explorers who went into the Amazon never found any of this. And so it was widely assumed that these accounts were simply products of the conquistadors' fervid imaginations. And essentially, they wanted to justify to their kings who had sponsored their expeditions the disastrous nature of them. And so they basically ginned it up a little bit. Well, Fawcett looked at all these early accounts and he found that there were a lot of similarities that he was not prepared to dismiss. And then one day, he was trekking through the Bolivian floodplains, and he came upon these large earth mounds. He was trekking up over one of these earth mounds, and he looked down on the ground, and he saw something sticking out of the ground, a little bit kind of shimmering in the sun. He bent down, picked it up, and it was a shard of pottery. And he began to scratch everywhere in the soil. And everywhere he scratched, at least according to his account, he found bits of old brittle pottery. Now, this is an era before carbon dating, so he didn't know how old it was. But to him, it looked very ancient, and it looked to him as refined as anything he had seen from ancient Greece or Rome. And that wasn't all. He began to look out from these earth mounds. And when he looked out, because it wasn't just one, there were lots of them in the floodplains. And when he looked out at them, he saw buried just underneath the growth, kind of the swampy land, what looked like straight lines. And he could swear it looked as if they were roads or causeways, the very dreamlike things that the conquistadors had described. And so in 1925, after years of battling skeptics and being driven virtually mad by his obsession with finding this place that he called Z, he finally set out to find it. And he took with him only two men. His son Jack, who was 21, who adored his father. He was very dashing. He looked like a movie star, and indeed he had aspirations of becoming one when he returned from this expedition as a famed and celebrated explorer. Here they are early on. The second companion, or the third companion, was Raleigh Rymel there on the right. And Raleigh was Jack's best friend. They had grown up in the countryside of England. They had done everything together. And though they didn't have any exploring experience, Fawcett believed they were ideal for the mission, tough and loyal. And that was extremely important because one of the things that often happened on these expeditions in the isolation of the jungle when the conditions were very bad was mutiny. That was a problem that plagued Amazonian expeditions for centuries. And Fawcett believed that on such an arduous expedition, having such loyal members, that would not be the case. Now, Fawcett was very secretive by nature. And I didn't mention this earlier, but before he went to the Amazon, he had actually been a British spy, which was very common back then. The British Empire liked to recruit mapmakers as spies because it was the perfect cloak to go in into other countries and basically infiltrate them and gather secrets. And he was, by very nature, secretive. And at this time when he was going, he had many rivals that were also on the path of this El Dorado or this ancient civilization. And so he would often, he would use codes, even in his letters, to his wife so that nobody could figure out where he was going. And she would have a cipher that she would use to decode these letters. And here you can see a map. It's a little bit hard to see, but this is the area where Fawcett was going. This is a map he drew. I showed it to you earlier. It's in the Mato Grosso region. Mato Grosso is in a Brazilian state in the southern basin of the Amazon. Mato Grosso literally means dense forest. He was going down here from Cuiabá, which was the capital of Mato Grosso, and then he was going to head up this way and move up into this area. But nobody knew exactly where, and you can't probably see it, or certainly I can't, but all along here, Fawcett had written unexplored. Now, they were going to take pack animals for a while, and Fawcett would do these on his expeditions. He would usually take them for about 3 weeks into the denser jungle, and then the animals would slowly break down and die. And in fact, the only clue to Fawcett's whereabouts once he got into the denser jungle was a place called Dead Horse Camp, and it was where he had shot a pack horse, and he had actually released these coordinates. So most expeditions, and most people, other than that one place up in the southern basin of the Amazon, this Dead Horse Camp, that was really the only strong clue to where Fawcett was going once he headed deeper into the wilderness. Here is Fawcett on his expedition. Now, while I said he only took two other men with him, there was three of them in the party, they did take two porters, kind of slash guides, for the early part of the expedition. They accompanied them for about a couple months, but once they got into the denser jungle, the guides, and they were heading more into hostile territory, the guides became very nervous and they were sent back. And one of the really interesting things was they would carry back with them letters and dispatches that Fawcett wrote. And throughout Fawcett's expeditions, he actually wrote dispatches, handwritten dispatches, describing what was happening. And these were then carried out of the jungle by either these two men or Indian runners that they would encounter, who would then carry these out of the jungle. And they would emerge weeks later, carried by foot. They would be all wrinkled and wet and crumpled. They then eventually be transported to the nearest city. They would then be typed up on telegraph machines and almost in like a feat of magic, blasted around the world. And so the whole world on every continent followed this event, essentially holding its breath. And it really was one of the first early all-consuming modern news events. And these dispatches went on for about 5 months, and then suddenly they just stopped. Now Fawcett had warned that he might be out of contact for a year, but then another year passed. The fascination grew. People wondered, had they died? Had they starved? Were they wounded? Were they needed rescue? It was very hard for people to believe that Fawcett could die because he was seen as so indestructible and he had survived so many expeditions. And the mystery of what happened then began to generate endless chatter. I mean, there are cables back and forth between leaders of all the countries debating how can we rescue these men. And novels sprang up. There's an Evelyn Waugh novel, A Handful of Dust, which is influenced by the Fawcett story. There were adventure stories. Here's one. Henry Verne, who was a French pulp adventure writer, which was pretty popular back a while ago, has one there you can see with the Fawcett mystery. Even the Tintin series, which some of you may know, a Fawcett character appears. Here you can see him on the bottom, looking bearded. And according to this story, he was so happy in the wilderness, he just didn't want to go back to civilization. Indiana Jones is often reputed to have helped and been at least partly inspired by the Fawcett character. And there's even a book tied into the movie series where Fawcett appears and Indiana Jones and Fawcett escape by jumping into the River of Death. Fawcett had warned that nobody should follow in his wake due to the danger. But despite this warning, scores of adventurers and scientists plunged into the wilderness, determined to recover the party alive or dead, or to find evidence of Z. Many of them died from starvation and disease. Others were killed by tribesmen. And then there were many of them that simply disappeared along with Fawcett. In 1928, the first major search party was launched by this man, Commander George Dyett. And there was later a movie made about, Hollywood movie made, came out in the 50s that was made about his trip. And one of the interesting things about that movie is that Dyett was one of the first Amazon explorers ever to bring a movie camera into the jungle with him. And he actually filmed parts of his expedition. And so when they made the Hollywood movie, they actually spliced in some black and white footage from his trip. And I just want to cue up a little bit of that pulpy movie and you get a sense of the melodrama.
10 miles from Rio and was heading up the Paraguay River. Destination Cuyaba, gateway to the Mato Grosso. Beyond lay a wild, savage country from which no explorer had ever returned. That was where I would follow Fawcett's trail. I'd met him once. Respected him. He was a veteran explorer, one of a vanishing breed of men the world could ill afford to lose. I hoped I would be equal to the task. And there was the mystery of the lost city. Would I find him there alive, amid the descendants of some forgotten race, living in splendor? These were my thoughts as we passed the native villages, little changed in hundreds of years. Night on the river can be a beautiful.
There's a certain absurdity to these, but it gives you some sense of the fascination and the way the story was perceived for generations. Dyett was lucky. He made it out alive. Others weren't so lucky. This man here on the left, the Swiss trapper looking at a map with the British consul, believing where he thought he would rescue Fawcett, was never seen again. Our movie star here, who had cameos in The King of the Wild in Hollywood and hoped to become the next Stanley to Livingston, was never seen again. One of the things that interested me about this story was that the fascination with the mystery and the determination to solve it wasn't something that just compelled people in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, or the 50s. It actually continued into the present. And in 1996, a major Brazilian expedition went, led by this man on the right, James Lynch, a Brazilian adventurer and financier. He took his son with him, which seems to be a reoccurring theme in the book, who was 16 at the time. And they were ultimately kidnapped by a tribe and held captive and eventually escaped after several days in captivity. So when I began this story, my own quest, it really began in a way much more suited to me. It was a biographical quest. It was a quest of detection to try to figure out not just the mystery of Fawcett's death, but the mystery of Fawcett's life. And I began to travel all over the world trying to find in archives, which I'm very well suited for, diaries and letters from his companions. Fawcett had been very secretive, and because of that, and there had never really been a major biography about him. And the family had also kept many of Fawcett's papers private. And eventually, I had gone to Cardiff, England, where I had tracked down Fawcett's granddaughter, a lovely woman named Roulette. And she had invited me into her house, and we chatted for a long time. And finally, she said to me, "So you really want to know what happened to my grandfather?" And I said, "Well, if it's possible." And she led me into a back room. And in that back room, there was an old chest. She opened up the chest, and inside were all these books. The bindings were disintegrating. They were covered in dust. They were breaking apart. And I said, "What are they?" And she said, "They're my grandfather's diaries and logbooks." Now, for Fawcett, his Z was, that was his treasure. For me, this was my kind of treasure. And I poured through these looking for clues. And one of the things I noticed when I was looking through these logbooks, I came across in his 1921 log the words Dead Horse Camp. And by Dead Horse Camp, I saw some coordinates. And I looked at the coordinates, and then I quickly went through my notebook where I had written down the coordinates for Dead Horse Camp that had been released publicly. And they were significantly different. And this astounded me. And what I realized, and what the granddaughter confirmed, was that Fawcett had used the other coordinates simply as a ruse to throw his rivals off the path. And what it meant was that many of these search parties had always headed in the wrong direction, and often fatally. Here on the map, you can see the Dead Horse Camp where people assumed was his last known camp in the southern basin of the Amazon. Here, at least according to his diaries and logbooks that were secret, was the actual camp. Now you have to understand, this is utterly impenetrable jungle. And in that kind of territory, that's a vast difference. And according to other evidence which I was able to uncover, including other coordinates which he gave, he did not head all the way north this way. He actually went from here and he cut eastward, cutting across towards the Xingu. And it was at this point that I really became consumed with a mystery and decided to do something stupid. I said, "Well, I got the coordinates. What am I going to do with it?" And so I decided to see if I could trace Fawcett's path and uncover evidence of what might have happened to him and the city of Z. Now, even today, the Amazon remains in places unexplored. The Brazilian government estimates that there are 60 tribes in the Brazilian jungle alone that remain uncontacted. In 2006, members of a nomadic tribe in the Colombian Amazon had emerged from the wilderness saying they were ready to join the modern world, though they were unaware that Colombia was a country, and they wanted to know if the airplanes overhead were on an invisible road. And here's a member of that tribe. Where Fawcett had disappeared was in the Xingu region. This is an area, it's an indigenous reservation today. It wasn't in Fawcett's day. It's about the size of Belgium, and it's one of the largest swaths of territory on the planet that remains under indigenous control. And because of the bloody history of the contact, you can't just wander onto these territories. They really function almost as countries within a country. You need to negotiate with the tribal leaders and get permission to go on. So I needed to find a guide. Now, that wasn't the easiest thing in the world when I would call people up in Brazil and say, well, I got this idea, you know, I kind of want to follow this guy. And they said, I say, disappear. Well, when did he disappear? Well, 80 years ago. And they all kind of would look at me and think about me. And some of them had heard of Fawcett, and they said, well, we're muito ocupado, which seemed to be a polite way of saying you're out of your mind. But eventually, I did persuade a nice guy, Paulo Pinochet, to come with me. And the funny thing about Paulo is he looked like that even before we set out. He was a professional samba dancer, and but he had also once worked for FUNAI, which was the Brazilian agency set up to protect the indigenous population. And so he would help us to make contact with the tribe so we could pass into the Xingu territory. And we tried to follow Fawcett's trail. Here's your fearless reporter with his pad in hand, crossing a bridge. And here we are trying to push a boat with some Pecari Indians through the wilderness. I wanted to cross a river which Fawcett had crossed. Now, I had all of Fawcett's letters with me. And Fawcett had described at one point crossing a river where there was a violent thunderstorm and Jack had to swim across the river. And Fawcett was extremely proud of his son. And so we were trying to cross that river. There we are doing that. The river was very calm when we went across. One of the most interesting things about this trip, and one of the things I try to do in the book, is alternate chapters between the past and the present to show how the world has changed, to show how exploration has changed, to show how the Amazon has changed. And at one point, we tried, for example, to find Galvo's ranch. And here you can see it on this map over, is that it? Galvo's ranch? Yeah. And in Fawcett's letters, he had described, after hacking through the jungle for about 5 weeks, Raleigh was had jaundice and had a lot of inflammation, and his foot was swollen. And they were looking for a place to rest. And this ranch was kind of the last settler kind of outpost that a settler had pushed so far out. And it was a large ranch. The settler, Galvo, was known to be extremely ruthless. And he had pushed out into this territory. They stayed there for several days. So I knew where it was based on the description of the river. It was by Rio Nova. We went to Rio Nova. Then we asked some Pecari Indians, and they said, oh, of course, we know Galvo's ranch. Galvo had a notorious reputation in that territory. And so somebody said, we'll show you it. And he took out a machete, and he started to hack through the jungle. And he hacked, and he hacked, and he hacked. We followed behind him, and then he slammed his machete directly into the ground. And he said, right here. And we said, what do you mean, right here? There's nothing here. And he said, no, right here. And we looked around. And sure enough, when we looked more closely, we could see some bricks. And the ranch had been utterly consumed by jungle in just a few decades. And there you could just see a piece of that ranch. And it was really at that moment that I had some sense that a city really could, that the remnants of a city really could be consumed and swallowed by the jungle and seemingly vanish. One of the other things that was very shocking in following the trail, and this happened earlier in the trip when we set out from Cuiabá, is I was reading Fawcett's letters. Now, Fawcett would describe in these letters the ordeal of moving through this dense jungle was so thick. At one point, him and Jack became separated. And I was looking out, and I didn't see anything. There wasn't a single tree. It had all been cut down, the entire jungle. And it looked like Nebraska. And there you could just see the burnt stumps. And so here I am holding his letters, reading his descriptions, and I'm looking at this. And again, it just shows you, gives you some sense of both the level of deforestation, which is quite shocking, and how the world has changed. Here's another picture of that. And these are going to be soybean farms. Now, we eventually moved towards the Pecari Indian settlement. Now, in Fawcett's day, the Pecari Indians were the first tribe in the Mato Grosso region in this Xingu area that had been contacted by the government. And in Fawcett's letters, he describes the horrible sickness from the contact and the Indians dying and the great sickness. In fact, there was a little girl who was very sick. Fawcett tried to save her and was unable to do so. And when we got to the Pecari settlement, this woman here was the oldest woman in the village. She's about 100 years old. She didn't know her exact age. And she was a little girl when Fawcett and his party came through. And she was actually able to describe for us seeing them in great detail of what she remembered. And you have to remember, when Fawcett and his men would appear in these places, this was extremely unusual. This was the first whites they would often see and coming in. And so she remembered it, and she is probably the last person who's at least still alive who saw Fawcett alive and his men alive. We proceeded further into the jungle, into the Xingu area, and now we're into this huge reservation area. Now, according to Fawcett's coordinates, the city of Z would have been closer to this area, which is the Kwikuru settlement. It's a really beautiful settlement. Here you can see the plaza carved into the wilderness, and it's really quite large. You don't get a sense of its proportions in this picture. And all along the outside here are these wonderfully beautiful domed houses. And they're made with a kind of thatch. They're incredibly cool to be in. When we would camp outside in our hammocks, it was kind of miserable. And then when we get to stay in their settlements and stay in these houses, the conditions just improved remarkably. And these houses are bigger than this room, just so you have some sense of their size, much bigger. And they will fit extended families. The further you go into the jungle, a lot of the tribes have been able to preserve their traditions and their cultures much better. And here they're celebrating, the Kwikuru Indians are celebrating the whirlwind spirit. This is them celebrating the Kwarup, which is one of their most sacred rituals, which honors the dead. And the most interesting thing on my trip was that in the Kwikuru settlement, I eventually met up with this man here on the left, an archaeologist named Michael Heckenberger. And on the right is the chief of the Kwikurus, Afukaka. And Mike had been working in this region doing research for over a decade. And he told me he had conducted his own inquiry into Fawcett's fate. And he said that though Fawcett was an amateur, in many ways he understood things better than the professional scientific establishment had for the last few centuries. And then he led us out into the wilderness, and he showed us this deep ditch here where he, and I said, what is it? And he explained that it was a moat, and he had used carbon dating. This particular moat was dated to about 1200 AD, and he said these moats, which could be 30 feet wide, had once surrounded an ancient settlement, and they were a mile in diameter. And he had uncovered evidence of 20 pre-Columbian settlements in the very area where Fawcett believed he would find the city of Z. These settlements were occupied anywhere from 800 AD into the 1500s. They had roads built at right angles. They had bridges. They had large causeways. They had these big moats with palisade walls. The settlements were often interconnected, and a cluster of these settlements, which would be connected by these dreamlike causeways that the conquistadors had in fact described. Each one of these clusters of settlements had populations of anywhere from 2,000 to 5,000 people, or 2,500 to 5,000 people, which made them about the size of many medieval cities in Europe. Here's a slightly better picture of the moat. And on the bottom of these moats would be holes. And in those holes, they had built palisade walls. And the Indians, the Kwikurus, in one of their oral histories and legends, they had stories about palisade walls. Now, Heckenberger had helped upend this notion that people thought was once was impossible, and shown what Fawcett always believed was possible, that a glorious civilization could have arisen in the jungle. And other archaeologists are fueling this revolution. In the Bolivian floodplains, which I described earlier, these big, huge earth mounds where Fawcett had first identified his shards of pottery, an archaeologist from the University of Pennsylvania, Clark Erickson, has been doing research. He has found evidence of ancient pottery, and he has found that these huge earth mounds were actually man-made. There were ways to avoid the floods and the leaching process, and they were an ingenious way to be able to grow crops to generate enough food to support a larger population. Not only that, he's identified causeways and roads connecting these giant earth mounds. And he says that the engineering that went into building these mounds, that went into building these roads, rivals anything that the Egyptians did with the pyramids. These discoveries are not only changing our view of Fawcett, who was one of the more daring and eccentric explorers ever to exploring the Americas, but it's also really exploding our perceptions of what the Americas looked like before the time of Christopher Columbus. And I'd just like to close tonight by reading a short bit from an oral history. This is an oral history from the Kalapalo Indians. When I stayed with the Kalapalo Indians and spoke to them about Fawcett, they would tell oral histories. Now, they don't have written records, and they pass down their they preserve their past through this oral tradition. And these oral histories are really, they're almost like epic Homeric poems. They're quite beautiful. And to my surprise, they actually had an oral history about Fawcett and his men coming in. And again, they were among the first white men they had ever seen. And so this first, the frisson of this contact was a pivotal moment, and they had preserved it in their history. An amazing thing about the oral history is it included incredibly precise details, which I only knew about because, again, I had these letters that had been carried out that I had found in this chest, including, for example, that Fawcett always carried a musical-like recorder, which he had told his wife he took with him so that he wouldn't go mad in the solitude of the jungle. So I'm just going to read to you just a small segment of that oral history. One of them remained by himself while he sang. He played a musical instrument. His musical instrument worked like this. He sang and sang. He put his arm around me this way. While he was playing, we watched the Christians. While he was playing, then I'll have to be going, he said. The oral history continues and details how the Kalapalos, after the expedition left eastward, they could see their fire in the distance. Quote, there's the Christians' fire, we said to one another. That was going on as the sun set. The next day, as the sun set, again, their fire rose up. The following day again, just a little smoke spread out in the sky. On this day, Mabuk, their fire had gone out. It looked as if the Englishman's fire was no longer alive, as if it had been put out. What a shame. Why did he keep insisting they go away? Thank you so much.
We have time for some questions. There'll be two staff members with mics, so if you can just ask, wait for the mic so that we can capture the question for the video, that would be great. Thanks.
I would like to say I very much enjoyed your presentation, I would like to know if you could comment on the fate of all of these documents that the granddaughter had, because apparently you were taking the original with you in the jungle. And secondly, did these people who could match the Egyptians have ability to write?
Mm-hmm. Two good questions. The granddaughter would not let me take originals, so these were copies. only copies went with me. As far as we know, they did not have written records, just oral traditions that were passed down. Let me just add one other point really quickly. Our understanding of these civilizations were really just at the very beginning of this. And so our understanding of so much about them, and again, my knowledge comes from the archaeologist, not myself, is really just at the beginning. And what's essentially happening is the old patterns and the old paradigms are being shattered as more archaeologists go into this region using high-tech satellite imagery, the kind of tools that Fawcett could never imagine, and making these discoveries. And they're happening so rapidly and so quickly that every time we think we know something, it gets overturned. So, for example, it was always assumed that there wasn't stone in the jungle and they wouldn't build any of their settlements with stone. Instead, they would use these earth and wood and other things. But just recently, a stone observatory was found in the Brazilian Amazon that's now being called the Stonehenge of the Amazon. So again, this revolution is really at the beginning, and our understanding of a lot of these civilizations is just really at the beginning. So I just want to say that as a precursor, because anything I say, could change. And in fact, I'm always racing just to keep up before this lecture, so I kind of at least know what's happening. Okay.
Did your archaeologist friend have any idea why those civilizations collapsed in the Amazon?
Yeah, that's a great question. And yes, he did. And there's no question it was disease. And Fawcett had actually speculated that it was disease. And the timing on which these populations collapsed from their settlements is the 1500s. Well, the first conquistadors that came in 1542. And there's no question they correspond. And just how quickly the disease spread and the level of its decimation we're just beginning to understand. Now, for ages, we didn't think there were that many people in the Amazon, so we assumed that the level of the death from disease was much more minuscule. Well, they're finding black earth, this kind of black organic earth throughout the Amazon. Now, black earth is essentially earth that's been enriched through organic waste and also from charcoal fire, and it means there's been human presence there. And there's more about it that's very interesting. The Indians would often use this enriched soil, black earth, to actually grow crops. It was another way, ingeniously, to overcome the counterfeit paradise. But archaeologists are now finding so much of this black earth throughout the Amazon that they now believe that the Amazon may have sustained millions of people.
I'm familiar with a lot of the literature you're talking about, and I wonder if you've asked why most of the things that have been found have been around earth, the type of moats and causeways. What about the cultural artifacts that you would imagine you would find? Maybe bones don't exist in such acidic soil, but teeth, which are basically fossils, do. And if there were thousands of people, it would have been a fairly hierarchical society, which means that there would have been different types of burial sites, mm-hmm. especially for kings or chieftains, which is what they're discussing. Why haven't any of those been discovered? Especially if 5,000-10,000 people living in one community, mm-hmm. you would have to have some sort of cultural artifact mm-hmm. beyond the dirt.
Mm-hmm. It's a good question. To be honest, I don't know the answer. The only answer I would say is, at least from Mike, Clark. Let me take that back a step. For example, in Anna Roosevelt, if you're familiar with the literature, had found, for example, a cave near Santarem. Now, in that cave, she found evidence of human remains that dated the human presence of people in the Amazon about 10,000 years ago, which is about twice as long as people had once thought the human presence had reached the Amazon. So they have found some evidence of these settlements. In terms of bone, I don't have a good answer for your question. The only thing I know from Mike, and he always stressed this to me, was that they were really, like, even when I was there, he was really just beginning this process, even though he'd been doing this for a long time, in terms of the excavations, in terms of what they were finding. And he would always stress to me that, again, as I said earlier, they were really just at the beginning of trying to understand this. But I don't know because I don't know all the literature of all the different, if that is not the case or if that is the case in other places.
I recently read a book about Teddy Roosevelt's trip down the Amazon. I was wondering who influenced whom, Roosevelt and Fawcett. And also, Roosevelt almost died on that trip, pretty close to it. And also, he took his son. There's something about going into these life-threatening places and taking your son with you. Just wondering if there's any connection.
It's interesting. Fawcett was and Roosevelt were very aware of each other, and this so-called fraternity of explorers was not much of a fraternity. They were incredibly jealous of each other. And when you read their private writings about each other, their rivalry is intense, and their egos are fairly gigantic. And they pretty much pissed on anything the other man did. And so, in fact, when Roosevelt made his trek down the River of Doubt, many of the people in this exploring fraternity said, oh, he couldn't have done it. One explorer who was another explorer who was a rival of Fawcett said, Roosevelt had just stolen from his own journeys and it can't be true. Now, of course, it turned out to be true. Now, Fawcett never actually dismissed that Roosevelt had gone down the River of Doubt and found this this tributary, but what he did say was it was okay for an old man, and I think that's a direct quote. So they were very competitive with each other, and even the Amazon, which as I said before is about the size of the United States, was not quite big enough for all their egos.
Hi, I'm curious if you know of any researchers who are applying what's been found as far as sustainable tropical agriculture techniques from these ancient civilizations, like recreating the Terra Preta and some of these earthworks.
Mm-hmm. There are a lot of geologists studying it. I mean, one of the things that they're looking at is, was this black earth, this Terra Preta, you know, there's a big debate, and I'm agnostic about it because I just don't know enough, but was this Terra Preta purposely created by the Indians to overcome the soil by using kind of systemic charring and to put charcoal into the soil? And the Kayapo Indians, which were very close to where we were and to where Fawcett went, and in fact are part of that Jingu area, there have been researchers who have studied that, like Susanna Hack, to see, is this systemic charring, was it kind of purposeful? And I do know that researchers are now looking at this soil very closely, and I know some of the geologists have said that, you know, possibly trying to figure out how the soil was created to make soil which otherwise would have been leached of nutrients more fertile to use. They're looking at that, and some scientists have made claims that possibly this could even be used in other places like, you know, deserts or other things like that to make soil more fertile.
Yes, I just wondered, in 1932, Ian Fleming's brother, Peter Fleming, yeah, went looking for Colonel Fawcett. I just wonder if you're familiar with that expedition. It was a rather ill-formed and kind of half-hearted expedition, as I recall. A wonderful book about it.
It's a terrific
called Brazilian Adventure.
Yeah, it's a great book, and it was written, as you said, by Ian Fleming's brother, Peter Fleming, who was a travel writer. He actually went, I think he was working for the London Times at the time, and it was really, it's a wonderful book. It was really one of the first books to kind of satirize the whole kind of notion of the kind of Victorian notion of exploration. And while as an expedition it was kind of disastrous in terms of what it accomplished, it did produce one of the more lively and entertaining bits of travel writing. And there's a great quote from Peter Fleming, which I often think about when I was showing you some of the old iconography of the movies and stuff about Fawcett. He himself said that there was so much lore had grown up around the Fawcett mystery that it now formed a separate branch of folklore, like giant squid, I think he even said, which is something I studied. Okay.
What did Fawcett think of Hiram Bingham? Because wasn't he looking for El Dorado also?
Bingham was looking not so much precisely El Dorado, but he was certainly looking for Incan settlements. And Bingham's discovery really fueled Fawcett's imagination, and of course it also embittered him. Fawcett had been not so far from that area sometimes when he had crossed over the Andes in some of his expeditions. So, but it really did fire his imagination. And Bingham, you know, it made him a kind of celebrity. You know, he went on to become a senator, and Fawcett, you know, again, these egos in this area. So he was both, to answer your question, both fascinated, and it fired his imagination. It also filled him with envy, but he also thought that his discovery was going to be much greater. That he thought that while Bingham had found Incan settlements, and he actually had a guide, and now there's some dispute, but in any case, he had helped uncover these settlements. The Incan civilization had already been very well documented. Nobody had any question of what they had accomplished and that these places existed. And Fawcett believed that his discovery was going to be far more astonishing.
I have a question. Oops. not used to mics, but there's a book called 1491. You are aware of it?
Oh, yeah.
Because there's, yeah, I saw a talk by that author, and he talked about seeing mounds in the Amazon basin and roads that connected them that were raised above the floodplain, and also canals that were cut below the floodplain so that during the dry season they could go back and forth between the villages that were on mounds, and they could use the canals to tow things during the dry season, or they could use the roads to get across when it was wet. And also he talked about that they had tilled pottery shards like at least 6 feet down into the soil, that was one of the things they had come across in terms of providing soil structure where there essentially wasn't any. It was man-made soil structure. I just wondered what thoughts you had about that book.
I thought it was a great book. It came out after my expedition when I was done, and in my acknowledgments I cited as it was a really wonderful guide. It's much broader and it looks at the Americas as a whole, but it's a wonderful guide to a lot of this recent scholarship, which is overturning a lot of the paradigms about the way we look at the Americas.
Hi. I can't wait to start your book, especially after learning that you have this structure where you talk about the old and then the new and the old and the new. And my question kind of is about that. When you went into the jungle, did you find the insect experience to be similar to the Fawcett people? And the second part, what about those natives? What do they, have they become resistant? The insects don't bite them? I mean, they're naked running around in the jungle. Aren't the insects all over them too? Thank you.
My guide, Paolo, had this, believed deeply, he had a deep conviction in a Japanese ointment that he believed repelled insects, and I used it. I don't know if it was effective or not in terms of anything else, but he believed deeply, and he had this little bottle of ointment that I would use. The bugs were bad. They weren't unbearable, but the biggest difference, again, was I had malaria pills and yellow fever shots, and so as disconcerting as the bugs could be, and again, when we would sleep outside in hammocks and we were in the open, it was fairly unpleasant. We would use the nets, but the nets were really not fine enough. But again, the nets are better than they were in Fawcett's day. And I would try to sleep fully covered. But when we would stay in the settlements, it was much easier. And, in terms of the health of the tribes and the resistance, I'm not sure the answer to that question in terms of malaria and yellow fever in terms of affecting their populations. I mean, usually the diseases that were more prevalent, at least the ones when I was going in that I had to make sure were things like that I wouldn't bring in that could be spread.
You mentioned that Fawcett disappeared in 1925 and then the search party went out in 1928. Were you aware that in 1926 there was a very severe drought in South America? The flow in the Amazon at Manaus was 50% of the climatological mean. There were large portions of the Amazon on fire. It's well documented. A double El Nino. The Pacific was warm. The Atlantic was warm. Could that have anything to do with this? Have you ever stumbled on that aspect?
No, I wasn't aware of that. I don't know if that would have affected, you mean in terms of what happened to Fawcett or just in terms of the search parties, in terms of being able to find anything? I don't think so. I mean, I think with Fawcett, the oral histories, which I was told, are really pretty precise, and I really think hold pretty clear clues to what did in fact happen to them. I want to say May. I think May, a certain day in May. I'm blanking the exact date, but it was May.
I'm sort of concerned about, as this debate about how much population was in this area is still incomplete, or I'm not 100% certain that it can be true, but the thing that I'm concerned about is that the groups that are living there now are very in a sophisticated harmony with their environment, and that this idea that, you know, man, there's a battle between man and nature, that this is a deadly green hell that has to be conquered, and that somehow this vision of having civilized it and built all these causeways is going to contribute to chopping it down more, or you know, a kind of beginning to be outdated vision of people, planet, the harmony of life, how we should live, what we should be doing.
Yeah, I mean, one of the great debates, and one of the things that has made this debate particularly fraught, Betty Meagher's theories that are being challenged by a lot of these revisionist archaeologists. She was a real icon in many ways of the environmental movement and the idea of kind of preserving this area, and the idea of kind of if these landscapes had already been manipulated for many years, how is that different from other people coming in to kind of manipulate the landscape? And so that is clearly a concern. I think from an element, though, of what is there and the science shouldn't be shaped by that. It shouldn't cloud the judgment of what is there or what is not there. That element of the history should just be known and stand on its own, and the battle to protect these areas shouldn't be diminished at all by that in any way. And one of the things that struck me in staying in the Xingu area was that, you know, when you're going to get to the Xingu, and I showed those pictures of the deforestation, and then you get to the Xingu area, and the areas of the jungle that are really being preserved are actually the areas under indigenous control. And that they do, to your question, have a way of living in the forest and preserving it because they need it and they want it, and they have a way of having a sustainable living and still maintaining them. So I don't think there's necessarily as much tension in that.
Hi, I want to know what happened to all that gold. Are there oral histories from the Indians themselves that talk about cities of gold, or was it something that the Western explorers made up?
Yeah, I mean, it's always hard somewhat to define El Dorado, because in each description it's kind of like a moving piece where everybody's description has its own little fantastical quality. Now, there's never really been found any of that kind of great sense of gold. Now, the Amazon does have a lot of gold. There's a lot of, I can't think of the word, prospectors who come in into the rivers and look for gold. But they've never found evidence of this great gold. And Fawcett himself believed that the gold was an exaggerated romance. That's a direct quote from him. He thought that there might be gold, but that it had taken on in the conquistador's imagination something fabulous. So he, in his own conception of Z, had a little more grounded point of view. Although I should also say, Fawcett's conception of Z changed over time. Fawcett had gone and fought in World War I, and he was at the Battle of the Somme. And he essentially witnessed the collapse of Western civilization. He was there as they all said, up lads, up lads, up the ladders, and as tens of thousands marched into machine gun fire and died. And it was during that period that Z really began in his own mind to take on larger proportions. And by the end, you see a real discrepancy in his writing. It really becomes a far more utopian, not golden, but utopian thing, almost a counterpoint. And a place of, you know, not a Shangri-La, but it did become something more in his imagination. And you see that transformation in his writings, and it was very interesting to witness.
When are you going back?
Well, once was enough.
This will be our last question.
You had a explanation from your expedition about what you believed may have been the city of Z. Did you come to any conclusions about what happened to Fawcett?
I did. Again, I think I read you a little bit of a snippet from that oral history, and when you read it in its fullness, you definitely get a sense where they were going. I don't think they lived much longer after they crossed from the Kalapala settlement and went eastward. I don't think they were alive that much past that five-month period where you were asking when was their last note heard. They were last heard from Dead Horse Camp. It would have taken about a week or so, 2 weeks, to get to the Kikuru and the Kalapala settlement. They stayed there for a while, and then according to the oral history, they moved eastward. And the Kalapalas actually went to investigate their last camp. And I think you do, by the end, get a pretty good picture. But, you know, as my guide said to me, Paolo Pinochet, only the forest knows all. But I do think you get a pretty good sense. I would just say the last thing I'd say, just in closing, the one thing that always haunted me and that I did not know, and in this kind of obsession of biographical quest, was really for me to kind of know everything about Fawcett. And the thing I really always had to wrestle with in the book is this decision of this man, I had a little boy at the time, to take his son to die. And I always wondered in that moment of recognition of what did Fawcett think when he realized he had led his son to his death. Thank you so much.